Do you remember this new computer from the last video, which I built using the AT-C188 processor? Today, we're going to rebuild it from scratch and get rid of this ugly adapter I had to put together at the time. But this video wouldn't be possible at all without the great help from PCBWay. PCBWay is a PCB prototyping manufacturer. Multiple PCBs are their star products, ranging from standard PCB, flex PCB, advanced PCB, PCB assembly service and others. They also offer one-stop solution service. Apart from the inner PCBs, the outer enclosure could be finished as well, such as 3D printing, CNC machining, injection molding and others, covering different kinds of materials. With PCBWay, makers can realize their ideas into real projects. Apart from that, their open source community is pretty popular among the creators, especially the shared project section. Many PCBWayers have shared interesting electronic projects there. If you're interested in any of them, you can get the boards there directly. Check them out at PCBWay.com. While making the previous video, I thought, okay, why don't we put what we already have here on these breadboards onto a PCB? I thought that I could put the core of the computer with the CPU, latches and memories on a PCB and add a pin header to its edge with the signals allowing us to connect it to a breadboard and add even more peripherals to play with. And more I thought about the design of this PCB, new ideas kept coming to my mind. I finally ended up with a bit more complex design, which includes a few more chips which we haven't mentioned yet. But more about it in a minute. A PCB design isn't everything, it needs to materialize. And for that, PCBWay were ready to help. After only a few days, I got these. Very good quality, very cheap PCBs from PCBWay. I'm gonna start soldering in a second, but first let me explain what this PCB houses. Most obviously, the square area here is the CPU, the AT-C188. Then we have a RAM and flash chips, the latches in the address bus. These two are the NOR and NAND gates, which were also apparent on the breadboards. Here we have the 74244 buffers for our buttons. This time I used all 8 input for the buttons, which, together with the RC filters, are in this corner of the PCB. The long pin header on the top presents all the required signals for attaching new peripherals on a breadboard. The shorter one on the left is the text LCD header. There are 4 more spaces for chips and even more pin headers, which I will not populate today, but we will surely come back to them in the future videos. Okay, let me start soldering, but please remember that this is very first prototype which probably hides some mistakes. I just hope that I will be able to fix them easily. To be honest, I had already found one issue in my design before I even started soldering, which was fortunate because I could easily correct it. Let me explain my mistake. As you might remember, the AT-C188 has 3 timers, which all can be clocked from the CPU clock, or 2 of them, timer 0 and timer 1, can also be clocked from an external source, and each of them have an allocated pin, timer in 0 and timer in 1. I thought that I wanted to use timer 0 as a system timer, clocked from the CPU clock, and therefore didn't plan to use its input pin, so I simply put it to the ground. Unfortunately, I missed the fact that if you want to use the CPU clock as the timer 0 source, the input pin works as a gate allowing counting up when it's high or stopping the timer when it's low. You can see my mistake now. When the timer in 0 input is pulled down to the ground, it blocks timer 0 permanently. I need to pull it up to enable timer 0. You could say that I could use timer 2 instead, like I did in the previous video, but there is a reason for the future development for which I would like to avoid using timer 2. I wonder if you can guess this reason. Put your ideas in the comments section, please. As a clue, I can say it has something to do with the interrupts. Enough talking, let's finally see a soldered PCB. Here it is. I populated all the sockets which are required for our test today. So obviously we've got the CPU here, the latches, RAM and flash in the ZIF socket so I can easily program it. Oh, and that's a 244, which is the buffer for our buttons. Similarly to what we had on a breadboard, I soldered in only 2 out of 8 buttons. I designed space for all eight of them. So we've got the RC filters soldered in for these two. Later we can obviously add more buttons, but currently this PCB represents what we had on breadboard previously as much as I could do it. These are the gates which were on the breadboard as well. That is our text LCD pin header, and you may find it odd, but this pin header here is soldered on the other side, and that's exactly to allow me to put this PCB on a breadboard to expand our build in the future. The rest of the sockets are unpopulated. We will put some chips into them later and in next videos, but for now let me show you the fix I mentioned. I had to cut off pin 20 of the CPU off of the ground, and also I had to add this resistor which pulls up the same pin to the VCC. This is a small bridge to connect to ground planes, because I disconnected this small ground plane by scratching off the pin 20. On this close-up a second ago, you might see that I'm using the ATC 188, not the XL version which I was using in the last video on the breadboard, and that's because I tested this PCB before recording this video, and it came out that the XL version behaves weirdly and it's not starting correctly. I don't know yet why. I'm gonna investigate it and let you know with my findings when I discover what happens to the XL version. But the base version, C188, works correctly, which you will see in a second. Okay, let's now connect the text LCD to this pin header and try to run the program. As you can see, the computer is working and the program, which I only modified to update the I/O addresses, which slightly changed from the breadboard to this PCB design. But the rest of the program is, as you can see, exactly the same. So it counts up seconds in the middle of the screen. You might notice that I used 8 megahertz crystal here in this design, which is exactly the same like on the breadboard in the previous video. That gives 4 megahertz clock for the CPU, and despite the fact that the CPU can run twice as fast, so I could use 16 megahertz here to get the 8 megahertz clock. But when I tested it before recording, I noticed that the LCD doesn't work well with such a fast CPU and sometimes misses some characters sent to it. I read the datasheet and it looks like the processor bus could be too fast with 8 MHz clock for the LCD. So that's why I came back to the 8 MHz instead, just to be sure that the LCD works as expected. The issue with the LCD made me think that it might be the best time to add the 8255, or the programmable peripheral interface chip, to our computer. It has a nice CPU interface with the regular data bus, the RD, WR and chip select signals, and gives us 3 8-bit ports which can be configured as inputs or outputs, and their states can be programmatically read or written. Well, maybe it's not as flexible as GPIO pins in today's microcontrollers, because you can't control the direction of each bit separately, but it's still quite useful. The 8255 can be configured to work in 3 different modes. 2 of them even allow raising interrupts when a certain input pin changes its state, for example. Today, though, I'm going to use it in the basic configuration called Mode 0, in which each of the ports A and B can be collectively configured as inputs or outputs, and port C is divided into two 4-bit groups whose direction can also be separately switched. There are two versions of the chip, broadly speaking, and it is very similar to the processors we have used. One is the original NMOS version, simply 8255, and the newer CMOS version, the 82C55. The main difference, from our point of view, is the speed. The original version works with a CPU clocked up to 4 or 5 MHz, while the C version works up to 8 MHz. The chip, apart from the standard signals I've already mentioned, also has two address pins, which means that there are four addressable registers. The first three directly represent all I/O ports, the A, B and C, and the fourth one is a control register, which configures all modes and pin directions. I thought that the text LCD would be a good device to test the 8255 with, so I can use it when I change the crystal to run the CPU with its full speed later. Of course, I could build the chip on the breadboard like I used to do, using the extension pin header on the top of the PCB, but in fact I had anticipated the need for it when I was designing this PCB and already had reserved a space for it here in this corner. The 2x13 pin header next to it exposes all the available I/O pins. Let's put the chip in. I've already made the required changes to the source code and the flash is already updated. I've written the code in a way which allows me to switch between the two implementations easily with one macro definition. It still only writes to the LCD and waits in a delay loop instead of checking the busy flag of the LCD, but it's really just a test code for our 8255 and I'm gonna improve it later. As usual, all the code is available on my GitHub page. That's it for today. Thank you for watching and please subscribe if you haven't yet. I'm planning to expand this computer even more and populate these empty sockets with more chips in the upcoming videos. The next one will give you a hint of what is going to go into the space in the top left corner. Subscribe if you don't want to miss it. See you soon!